Welcome to the life and legacy of Lillian Exum Clement. I'm happy to be here and hosting this. My name is Alana Pierce. I am the board president of the League of Women Voters. Just very quickly, if you haven't found it already, the bathroom is just by the coats back there and to the right. And over here on the left-hand table, there is some additional materials about the ERA and Lillian's life. If you haven't checked that out already, you can check that out after our program. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan, volunteer-based organization born out of the women's suffrage movement. We work in protecting the rights of voters, providing citizen education, such as election information, information on the democratic process and systems, and current issues that affect our democracy. This is the first in a series of events, Votes for Women's Centennial Series. As you'll see, I hope everyone received a flyer. This has the listing of all of our events in the series. Our next one is going to be May 4th, Women in Government. This one should be really great and lively, and it will be featuring local representatives, and we'll be partnering with the Girl Scouts. So that should be really interesting. And then our one after that will be in October. We also have an upcoming series next week, I think, March 19th, called Civics 101, and we will be focusing on how to advocate within our local government. So we'll have the first in the series will be advocating within your city government. In this case, it will be the city of Asheville. The second in the series will be April 9th, and that will be advocating in the county government. And then May 14th, we'll be working with the Board of Education. And so in each of those cases, local representatives will come as a panel of speakers, and we will be able to ask questions as the audience of, you know, how do we best communicate with you? If I have a certain issue, how do we make change on that issue? Also, if you're a member and you're interested in coming, or even if you're not a member and you're interested in coming to our annual meeting, that will be May 18th at 11:30, so you can pencil that in your calendars. That will be at the Holiday Inn in Asheville. Jim Blanton, the new library director, will be our speaker this year. It is my pleasure to introduce the creator, orchestrator, and maestro of all of these events. I really hope we can give her a round of applause, because Juanita has put so much energy and life and so much greatness into putting on these events. So board member Juanita Carrier will take it away. Thank you, Juanita.
I'm Juanita Carrier. I'm a member of the League of Women Voters. And I live in Swannanoa. We were given a job from State League. They wanted all the different chapters to come up with ways to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the League of Women Voters. And this area is so rich in history. Instead of one of it, we came up with three, because it was just it would not have done justice to all of the ideas that our committee came up with. Tonight is the first one of our events, and we look back at the past to the present. The one with the Girl Scouts, we look at the present to the future. I mean, women have had the vote for 100 years. What are we going to do the next 100 years? That will be our daughters and our granddaughters. And the very last event will just be a celebration at a wonderful historic home, the Patton Parker House, which held the very first suffrage meeting in North Carolina. And granddaughter of Mayor Patton, Mary Two Parker, was instrumental in getting the Asheville YWCA integrated, the first one in the South. And also, she was a founding member of the League of Women Voters. So that house has a lot of history for us. The program tonight is just wonderful, and I know you'll enjoy it. We've got got so much talent. It will begin with our lead member, Alex News, and she is a wonderful singer, which a lot of us didn't know. She's going to sing two authentic suffragette songs, and she will end the program with a female empowered anthem. So hold on to the seats on that one. Our actress is Samantha LeBrock, who is a graduate from Warren Wilson College. So another local girl. And she's a professional actress and just wonderful. Read on the handout all of the things that she's done. It's just amazing. And one of our members, Susan Fisher, will talk about Lillian's List, which is part of Lillian Clement's legacy. And we will finish up with Black Mountains on Roberta Madden, a longtime advocate and activist for ERA. So we move on. I have a couple of people I really need to thank. Abby Amon, back there, raise your hand so we can hear you, has done our lighting. And she is a real professional. Read on the program about Abby. And my dear friend, Sandy McDaniel. Sandy, would you raise your hand or stand up? She is the costumer for the Montford Park Players. Wow. And she did the costumes that Alex and Samantha will be wearing, and she also did their hair. So it's a really wonderful, exciting program. Lillian Clement broke so many glass ceilings before that was a term. And you look at what the suffragettes did. I mean, we've got posters here of Carrie Catt and Maud Park. Carrie Catt, I don't think we would have the 19th Amendment without her. And Maud Park was the first president of the League of Women Voters, this organization that was given birth out of the suffrage movement. But also look at the other two women. Those are women of color. And even though the 19th Amendment said women now have the right to vote, peoples of color were not given that privilege. It was not easy. And that somewhat continues today. I'm very proud of the League of Women Voters because we have our lawsuit, the end of March, goes before the Supreme Court, where we are basically saying that we need a different method of drawing our voting maps. We've got to do better. Lillian Clement said, you have to start a thing. And I am passionately proud of the League and our work towards protecting your vote. So after the program's over, we are going to stack the chairs for about 30 minutes. Please talk to us and talk to Samantha and Alex and Abby, Roberta, Suzanne, and Abby and, I'm sorry, Samantha and Alex have said they would be very happy to have their pictures made with you. So if you got your cell phone, one of our League members will take a hold of your phone and take a picture if you would like. We do take donations. To join the League, I think it's about $75 a year, of which National takes a poor portion of that, and State takes a portion, and we get $6. We are 130 members strong, so do that math. But we do manage to get blood out of a turnip, and we would appreciate any donation. But in particular, if you are not a member of the league and you are interested in the type of work we do, we would love to recruit you. So please also speak to Aiden in the back on our membership table. 2020 is coming up and we have a lot of work to do. So no further ado, I will turn this over to Alex, who will set the mood for us.
I'm going to announce the songs now. That way I don't have to do it later. The first song I'll be singing is titled Let Us All Speak Our Minds. It is a musical testament to the rise in popularity of the celebrated and stereotyped feminist. The second song I'm going to sing is titled Columbia's Daughters. The words are by Harriet Robinson, and the music is to the tune of Hold the Fort by Philip Bliss, circa 1870. So it was a very popular song to sing during the suffragette movement because everybody knew the hymn melody already. And then the last song I'll be singing, I have a little bit more notes on. Everyone knows Respect, the song, most notably by Aretha Franklin, but it was actually originally written and performed by Otis Redding. And the two versions are very, very different. Not only the music, but the lyrics as well. Redding's version is a plea from a desperate man who will give his woman anything she wants. He doesn't care if she does him wrong, just as long as she gives him his due respect when he brings money home. However, Franklin's version is very different and is a declaration from a strong, confident woman who knows that she has everything her man wants. She never does him wrong and demands his respect.
Men tell us 'tis fit that wives should submit to their husbands submissively, weakly. Though whatever they say, their wives should obey unquestionably, stupidly, meekly. Our husbands would make us their own dictum take, without ever a wherefore or why for it. But I won't and I can't, and I don't and I shan't. No, I will speak my mind if I die for it. For we know it's all fudge to say man's the best judge of what should be and shouldn't, and so on. That women should bow, nor attempt to say how they think that the matter should go on. I never yet gave up myself such a slave, however my husband might try for it. For I can't, and I won't, and I shan't, and I don't, but I will speak my mind if I die for it. And all ladies, I hope, who've had husbands to cope with the rights of the sex will not trifle. We all, if we choose our tongues but to use, can all opposition soon stifle. Let man, if he will, then bid us be still and silent, a price he'll pay high for it. For we won't and we can't, and we don't and we shan't. Let us all speak our minds if we die for it.
Clement. There's so much I want to tell you. I'm thinking back to my
night before serving for my district in the North Carolina House of Representatives. I was so excited, but so scared because I knew I had a huge responsibility in front of me. After all, I was elected before women had the right to vote. I beat the other two Democratic candidates in the primary, watched as the Republican candidate dropped out, and clobbered the lone independent candidate. Don't let anything stop you. I certainly didn't. My father came to the Swannanoa Valley to work on the railroads. That's where he met my mother. They already had two mouths to feed when I came along. I attended a one-room schoolhouse on an island in the river. We called it the School Between Two Creeks. And getting to school could prove to be an adventure. That all changed when the famous George Washington Vanderbilt called my father and offered him a job. He wanted him to run the small town that serviced the estate. So we moved, and I continued my education at All Souls Parish. When I graduated, I continued my education at Asheville Normal and Collegiate Institute. I took classes in everything from typewriting to stenography and bookkeeping, anything that would get me closer towards my ultimate goal of becoming a lawyer, even though they didn't let women into law school at the time. I began working as a clerk in the Buncombe County Sheriff's Office. I did that by day, and by night, I studied law under the guidance of the law offices of J.J. Britt and Robert C. Goldstein. This was all thanks to the encouragement of Edith Vanderbilt. I'm a conservative woman and staunch in my beliefs, but I've always been passionate about women's issues. I started an Asheville branch of the Congressional Union, which became known as the National Women's Party. Our goal was to achieve women's right to vote through a constitutional amendment. In 1917, I attended the North Carolina Suffrage Association in Charlotte and was elected their recording secretary. That was the same year I passed the bar, only the fourth woman to do so. The next year, I opened a private law office and won my first case within 2 months. The judge called me Brother Exum. It shocked some people, including the reporter who was reporting on the case. He was so shocked that I was a woman that he forgot to mention my client's name or the criminal charges. Then in 1920, the Buncombe County Democratic Party asked me to run for my district in the North Carolina House of Representatives. Like I said, I beat the other two Democratic candidates in the primary. The Republican candidate dropped out, and the final vote between myself and the independent candidate was 10,368 to 41. And I did this only spending $25 on my campaign. I only had a few short months to prepare for my new responsibilities in Raleigh. It's time to get to work. I'm gonna make my time in office count. I'm going to propose 17 separate bills during my time in office. Right now, a woman has to wait 10 years to file for divorce after her husband abandons her. I propose we reduce that to 5 years. Let's take advantage of modern science and require tuberculosis testing and inoculation of dairy herds to ensure that North Carolina has pure milk. This bill would prohibit railroads from hiring illiterates as firemen, flagmen, and brakemen. I propose we include a yellow caution light in our traffic lights to warn drivers to slow down. The Clement bill would grant voter privacy by allowing secret ballots and voter booths. That last one caused some backlash among politicians who wanted to buy votes, although they didn't say it that way. But it passed. In fact, 16 of the 17 bills I proposed did. After the House adjourned, I kept working. I took up the fight to help a house that was for delinquent girls and unwed mothers to be run by the state so it could have more funding and have more support. That received some backlash too. I was called a Jezebel for helping these so-called sinful women. One protester broke my nose. I also had vegetables and eggs thrown at me. But I wasn't discouraged. I set People were judging and condemning a woman, but their weapons weren't vegetables or eggs, they were hard stones. It's not for you or I to judge or condemn, but rather to render aid to the less fortunate. During my time in office, I married Asheville citizen reporter Elias Stafford. I only served one term before I went back to practicing law, but then Governor Morrison asked me to run the state hospital in Morganton, and I did my very best to run it. And then I became one of the founders of the Asheville Business and Professional Women's Club. Then, May 1923 was one of the most exciting and scariest times of my life. You were born. We named you Nancy Lillian Exum Stafford. Big name for such a little baby. Another first in our family. You were the first incubator baby in all of Asheville. But eventually I got to hold you in my arms and show you our beautiful mountain home. Lillian died just 2 years later. She was a trailblazer for women, especially in the South. She always believed there'd be women in government, but sometimes you have to start a thing. We've had the vote for 100 years. What will we do with the next 100?
About it, but we told them we'd take good care of it. I'm going to speak a little bit about Lillian's list. I'm not a member of this group. They couldn't get a speaker here today, but they submitted some information so we could talk about their efforts. Lillian's list began in 1997, and the source of their name should be obvious. This is a political action committee. It was founded on the idea that progressive women in North Carolina politics need a group that was committed to supporting them. You may have heard of Emily's List, which does a similar thing, but on a national basis. The mission of Lillian's List is to recruit, train, and support pro-choice progressive women who are champions for reproductive freedom and equity for women to run for office in North Carolina. They provide training for women who are considering running for public office, and they are going to have a session titled Get Ready to Run on April 6th in Asheville. This will include topics such as identifying the office to run for, building a team, crafting personal stories, and the all-important fundraising. They also hold training sessions for women who are actively running for office, for campaign staff, and for volunteers. Lillian's List has helped elect all of the pro-choice progressive women who have served in the North Carolina General Assembly since 2009. They have helped 65 women in North Carolina gain positions in the past 22 years. There are several Western North Carolina women who have received help from Lillian's List, and they include Senator Terry Van Dyne, who will be a member of our panel on May 4th with the Girl Scouts and is a member of our League chapter. Representative Susan Fisher, no relation, also a League chapter member. Former Representative Patsy Keever, another League chapter member, and former Representative Jane Wilden. If you want more information about Lillian's List, their website is lillianslist.org, and there's no apostrophe in that. Now my next duty is, and it's a happy one, is to introduce our next speaker, who is Roberta Madden. Roberta has worked for the Equal Rights Amendment for 47 years, ever since it was passed by Congress in 1972 and sent to the states for ratification. She lobbied for the ERA in Louisiana before moving to Black Mountain in 2009. She is co-director of Ratify ERA NC, an organization dedicated to putting the amendment into the U.S. Constitution. In addition, she serves on the boards of the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial Corporation of Swannanoa Valley and the Southern Mutual Health Association. She's an active member of the American Association of University Women, Business and Professional Women, the League of Women Voters, of course, the National Organization for Women, the NAACP, and the Women's Forum of North Carolina.
Program, and I'm glad to be part of it. Last week, I traveled to Raleigh with, there were about 200 women from all over the state, and we were there to meet with our legislators, but also to observe the introduction of the Equal Rights Amendment bills in the Senate and the House. These bills begin the whole process, once again, of ratifying the Equal Rights Amendment. We're players in an old American drama, the 96-year-old struggle to enshrine women's equality in our U.S. Constitution. What's the big problem putting the ERA into the Constitution? What does it say anyway? Probably some of you can recite it by heart. Equality of rights under the law shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. Sounds pretty simple. Why could anybody be against that? That's what I thought when I started working for the Equal Rights Amendment in Louisiana. I thought this is going to pass right away, but I was mistaken. All this began 96 years ago, 3 years after women won the right to vote. It was 1923 when the famous suffragist Alice Paul wrote the first version of the Equal Rights Amendment. And a lot of things happened next. It wasn't until 1940, however, that a major political party adopted the Equal Rights Amendment as a cause that they endorsed. That was the Republican Party in 1940. 4 years later, the Democratic Party put the ERA into its platform. Then we waited a long time. In 1972, the ERA finally passed Congress. And of course, it took a two-thirds vote, which is hard to get. Congress then sent it to the states for ratification, but they added a 7-year deadline. Well, pretty soon, didn't take long, 35 state legislatures ratified the ERA. In 1977, it came pretty close to passing here in North Carolina. It passed the House, can you believe it, in 1977 by 61-55, but lost in the Senate by only 2 votes. But then things began to slow down due to organized opposition by a woman named Phyllis Schlafly. I'm sure some of you have heard of Phyllis Schlafly, the late Phyllis Schlafly, and North Carolina Senator Sam Ervin. They worked together to slow down the process. And the progress for equal rights stalled. So then Congress said, well, we'll extend the deadline. We'll give it 3 more years. They did extend it to 1982. But in the meantime, there were no other state ratifications. And the deadline ran out. A lot of us were really discouraged at that point. But meanwhile, in 1992, another amendment to the U.S. Constitution was put into the Constitution, the Madison Amendment. That dealt with pay raises for members of Congress. A good amendment. It took 203 years from the time it started until it finally became part of the Constitution, when it finally got the 38 votes needed to ratify. That gave us new hope that this deadline was really not valid in our case. So we kept on working for equal rights. In 2010, I helped organize Ratify ERA North Carolina. 5 years later, the National ERA Coalition was organized. And then the very next year, here in North Carolina, we organized the ERA-NC Alliance. Then the year after that, Nevada ratified it. And nobody really knew that that was coming. We didn't know that Nevada was a likely candidate. It turned out that they had bipartisan support, and they made it happen. Then the next year, last year, Illinois ratified. And that was very exciting. It was quite close. I think they won by about 2 votes. I had a chance to listen on the internet to that debate, and it was very exciting. When it was over, my husband was listening too, my husband David, who is sitting here. We both stood up and embraced and cried. It was so exciting. We hope to do that here in North Carolina. The latest thing that happened was March 5th, 2019, when the Equal Rights Amendment was introduced in our legislature, House Bill 271 and Senate Bill 184. In the House, but the first time, we got a large number of sponsors, 55 sponsors and co-sponsors. That's 46%. And that took some doing, because most of them had never even heard of the ERA when they started. Terry Van Dyne said to me, you were the first person who ever told me anything about the Equal Rights Amendment. In the Senate, in the state senate, we got 21 sponsors and co-sponsors, and that's 42%. That too is a first. All the sponsors and co-sponsors happen to be Democrats. In fact, every Democrat in the legislature has sponsored this legislation. But the ERA North Carolina Alliance is nonpartisan, strictly nonpartisan, like the League of Women Voters. And we're trying very hard to get more Republican support. We believe that that will happen, but it's not happening right away. Well, why do we need it? Just a few reasons. The only right that's guaranteed to women in the Constitution now, as you know, is the right to vote. You know, this Constitution. Ruth Bader Ginsburg has said she'd like to be able to take this Constitution out and show her granddaughter that the Equal Rights Amendment is in there, but not yet. Protective laws that we have now can be overturned or not enforced. For example, Title IX is being weakened right now. And the equal pay law has a lot of loopholes. And the other thing is pay inequities. You know, I have a dollar bill here. It looks like a dollar bill, but actually it says 78 cents. I think that's now moved up to 80 cents. But this is how much a woman gets for every dollar that a man gets. Working. It's much worse for people of color. I think it says on the back, for black women, 64 cents, for Hispanic women, 56 cents. And you know, as we used to say in Reverend Barber's rallies, that ain't right. There are other inequities too many to go into, but one of them, of course, is women in combat. That was one of the big arguments that we used to hear against the Equal Rights Amendment. Well, women are going to have to go into combat. Well, we are in combat, many of them. Some women have died in combat. Others have lost their limbs. But they still face discrimination. And women in prisons face unfair sentencing. For example, if a woman, perhaps a victim of domestic violence, kills her husband, probably in self-defense, but she can't afford a good lawyer, and so she goes to prison, and she's going to serve more time than a man who kills his wife. On average, that's the way it is. So what could the Equal Rights Amendment do about these kinds of discrimination? Well, it's, of course, the basic legal remedy for women and for men, because sometimes men are discriminated against as well. It would make sex discrimination subject to a legal term. It's called strict scrutiny. That's the same test that's used for race and religion discrimination. As it is, the courts created a separate category for women. They call it intermediate scrutiny. Well, your chances, if you have a case and you're using strict scrutiny, your chances of winning that case are 80%. But if you're going under intermediate scrutiny, which only really applies to sex discrimination, your chances are 50-50. So what can you do about this? Well, the first thing, of course, is to become informed. There are a number of good websites about this, and the list of three of them is on the back of this little brochure. There's some of those brochures over there on the table. I hope you'll take one. This was produced by the group that I started, Ratify ERA NC. So learn about it. Talk to your friends about it. There was a poll done that showed that 94% of Americans think that the Equal Rights Amendment ought to be in the Constitution. But the same poll showed that 80% think it's already there. Well, that's the problem. People just don't know. So we got to start talking to people about this. Talk to your legislators and your legislative leaders. Urge those people in power to hold hearings on the Equal Rights Amendment. That's been one of the biggest problems in the last few years since we first brought it up in 2015. They refused to hold a hearing. I used to lobby for Common Cause in Louisiana, and I found that any legislator who had a bill that he or she wanted to have a hearing for could do that. The chairman would always call a hearing, a public hearing. That bill might not get any votes, but at least it had a hearing. We can't get that here in North Carolina, and it's kind of embarrassing that North Carolina is not as progressive as Louisiana. Get that. So it's important that we try to make sure that at least we get a public hearing on this. And another thing that you can do, of course, is to call your members of Congress and urge them to co-sponsor legislation that will eliminate the deadline. We think it's already eliminated, according to some scholars, but just to make sure, we want Congress to pass this legislation. Looks like it has a pretty good chance in the U.S. House to just plain eliminate the deadline. And that goes along with what we're doing on the state level. Now, North Carolina can be the 38th and final state to ratify. So the eyes of the nation are really upon us. Another thing you can do, of course, is join the ERANC Alliance. I put a few brochures over there, applications if you would like to join. You can write a letter to the editor, an op-ed piece, and get that in the newspaper. And you may think nobody reads the newspaper anymore, but the fact is politicians do. And if they see a lot of letters and op-eds about the Equal Rights Amendment, they're going to sit up and take notice. There are a couple of them that came out just in the last 10 days. Maybe some of you saw it. An excellent op-ed by Linda Stover, who is an officer of the Alliance, and another one by Senator Terry Van Dyne, and two other female senators. That was in just a few days ago. Martin Luther King Jr. often quoted Reverend Theodore Parker, "The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice." President Obama had a new interpretation of that famous quotation. He said, "But here's the thing, it does not bend on its own. It bends because each of us, in our own way, put our hands on that arc and we bend it in the direction of justice." Thank you.
Our speakers were great, and thank you all for coming and participating. I think that's been a really fun event. We hope that you'll come to the other two parts of our 100th anniversary celebration in May and in October. There are other events going on. We also hope that you will hang around now and take some snacks. We've got Girl Scout cookies, among other things. Have some snacks and look at our displays. We've got some wonderful posters and materials you can look at, and take a close look at Lillian's suit. And from League of Women Voters, we welcome your donations. There's a jar on the food table, another jar on the membership table, and please consider joining the League if you're not already a member, or at least pick up some of our materials and take a look at them. So thank you very much.